Okay. Hi, Jim Ziegler, the Alpha Dog, and we're talking dealer socket today. Let me do a little housekeeping here for a second and be sure we got everything set up properly so everybody can see the broadcast. Oh, you guys are so good looking. Look at you two. All right, where's my little public icon? Public icon. Done. We are public. I say we are. Come on, Facebook. Keep a close watch on this heart of mine. Yeah, come on now. So Facebook's cutting circles on me right now. I'm going to get this done. Okay, I have Darren Harris and Melissa Marcus. Is that right?
That's right.
From Dealer Socket. Free convention, special news issue. Tell me what your positions are, how long you've been with Dealer Socket. Let's get the preliminaries out of the way.
Absolutely, Melissa. You want to go first?
Yeah, I'll start. I've been with Dealer Socket, just rounded my sixth year. Been in the auto industry my whole life, mainly on the technology side, and came to work for Dealer Socket shortly before NADA 2012. I'm the director of enterprise sales. I've worn many hats, as have Darren, but I'm excited to be where I'm at, working with some of the largest groups in the country on the sales side.
So, fantastic. Darren?
I'm Darren Harris. First of all, let me say it's an honor to be speaking with a legend.
Yes.
Yeah. It's an honor. It really is. It's a privilege. We're really grateful to be here and that you'd have us here today. So I've been with Dealer Socket. I'm now in my 14th year here. So I was the 14th employee with the company. We're now over 1,100 strong. I've seen a lot of different things here. I'm very, very close with the two founders, the original founders of the company, Jonathan Ord and Brad Perry. They convinced me to leave public accounting. I used to work for PricewaterhouseCoopers in a prior life in Los Angeles, and I worked on some big accounts like Disney and ABC Radio Networks and the Lakers and Toyota here in the Southland. So I ended up coming over here as what we would call a consultant, so running implementations of our CRMs. And for about a year and a half, I was in dealerships every single week on the road, just a road warrior. And then I started selling for us because I really wanted to learn how to sell and was fascinated by the car business. And so I started selling. I did that for about 2 years. And then I got back to my roots as a CPA. That's my background. I don't have my pocket protector here with me today. Yeah, I'm a little bit like Jonathan would mention it. Jonathan Ord, our founder, is very similar. He's kind of screwed up in the head, similar to me. Half of me is a pure sales guy and half of me is an accountant. So I kind of, I'm really screwed up in the head, to be honest with you.
That's Jekyll and Hyde right there.
Yeah, you have no idea. My wife battles that all the time and is frustrated with me for a lot of those reasons. But I ended up becoming our CFO, and I know our business pretty well, the financial side of our business. And then last year I became our COO. I got back into the more of a customer facing and operations related role and have been trying to champion a lot of the betterment and the changes that we've been making in our business. And most recently here as of January 1, something that's new for our business is we decided to look at our business a little bit differently. We decided to split our business to look at it from a franchise dealer perspective and an independent dealer perspective. So buy here, pay here, and retail used car dealers, and try to divide our business that way. And now my technical title is the chief of franchise. But really you can think of me as the GM over the franchise business. So I really focus on franchise dealers. That's why NADA, this is a big deal for us coming up for me personally. We work a lot with the OEMs as well.
Fantastic. Now, I'm going to ask you to tell me a lot about Dealer Socket. You know, I've been friends with the company for a long time, friends with the people in the company. And tell me what's new and exciting. Let's start there. What is new? What's exciting? What innovations? What are we doing?
So do you want to maybe hit on some of these quick hits?
I'll speak to that. We're super excited for NADA this year. We've got a lot new coming out across our platform. For people,
well, I knew that. I just want them to know that.
So many people know Dealer Socket as CRM. We've grown over the last 5 years to be more than that. Now we're a true platform player in the space. We have the Dealer Fire website program, Inventory Plus. With each of those products, we have a lot new coming out at NADA. Blackbird we rolled out, many people know, a couple years ago. We've made tremendous improvements to speed, performance, customization of the homepage, making it super easy to use. I'm excited to share that. We also brand new have Ring Revenue Radar Ping scoring. It's an industry first, allows users to be able to identify from our Revenue Radar program, of course, using from within the CRM if they like, the highest gross, highest closing opportunities, and ranks them quickly and easily for them. On the Dealer Fire side, we have a lot new coming out. For those of the people watching that haven't seen Precise Price, it's our digital retail platform. We've got that and a lot of improvements, enhancements to that. And to add to a giant mouthful of a response on the inventory side, we've rolled out Absolute Sourcing.
Oh, that's a mouthful. You know, I'm most impressed with like Revenue Radar. Yeah. You know, equity mining is so big with me and some of the things you're doing. By the way, we've got a little audience here. Linnea White-Longette is on, Lance eBay, Michael Richards, great company, Jim. Yeah, here's what he said. Okay, Kevin O'Brien, Jim Bernardi, David Cribbs. We're starting to pick up some friends on the network. So tell me, let's start with Revenue Radar. That's a personal favorite of mine. Tell me what the product does.
So Revenue Radar is DealerSocket's data mining solution. We have over 11 mm-hmm. different radars that will search through the dealership database to find customers that are in equity, that we can lower their APR, that are about to go over their lease miles. There's a number of different criteria that we search for, and we present those opportunities to the dealers from within the mobile, from within the CRM, and as a standalone tool as well. And really the defining difference for us is that it lives within the CRM if you'd like. So rather than having to use multiple different technology silos, which is a problem a lot of dealers face today, there's all this great new innovative technology out there, but you end up becoming a little bit paralyzed with, well, this is a great tool I use over here, this is a great one over here, but they don't really work together. So Revenue Radar fits seamlessly within the CRM, and now with the Ping scoring, we rank the highest opportunities and we can drip them in. So as a salesperson, when I come in for the day, I see my highest gross, highest close, highest CSI opportunities right in front of me.
I think that's the biggest thing for me about Revenue Radar, and I love that product. I love the connected aspect of it. When you're in the CRM, it doesn't feel, look, or function as though it's some disparate system that has nothing to do with the rest of the technology. It's truly embedded in there. So based on your navigation points, when you're a user, you might be any type of user. You could be a GSM that's running your sales floor. You could be the newest sales rep. You get alerted and notified, which more information becomes empowering to the dealer. And that's really, really important. So these Ping rankings, and you know, you flip the switches and turn all these rules on in the background that's spinning through the data to serve up new information, new leads. But now what Melissa just mentioned in this Ping scoring, these Ping rankings, it takes all of those new pings that you'll get that are served up to you. And then there's an algorithm that's running behind the scenes that's actually going to serve up, hey, these are the most likely to buy. So this is, you start thinking about these buzzwords now, like artificial intelligence and machine learning and all that. This is moving in that step of, hey, there's a more intelligent way that technology can enable our wonderful salespeople to go do the jobs that they're really, really great at. Just trying to put up there in terms of prioritization, better leads to go after and go work.
You know, Darren, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Because you know, it's easy to talk over each other in this thing. It's amazing. You mentioned enable. And I've always been, people want the CRM to do the work for them. It's an enabler. It's a productivity magnifier. And you know, I use CRM myself, and my God, I make 100 outbound phone calls in a given day out of this office. And I'm juggling all these projects. I had a friend of mine who is a professional juggler, and he said he could never juggle six balls until he tried seven.
That's interesting.
Yeah. Melissa, you're about to say something there.
Oh, yeah. I was just going to speak to, you know, the simplicity, because I as we were talking about, there's a lot of great technology out there. But what I think dealers struggle with is, you know, really adapting when a dealer invests to put good technology in their hands. And, you know, one of the things I love about Revenue Radar and Precise Price, our digital retail platform, and Inventory Plus is that it really helps dealership users buy in that, you know what, this technology is going to help me sell more cars. With the real-time notifications that come through on the mobile, it really engages the salesperson. So we don't go back to the old school of, hey, you know, this technology is too complicated. Let me just jot this down on a piece of paper. So that's what I love about it the most.
That's right.
You know, I coined a phrase a while back that's gotten around the industry, marry your CRM. Mm-hmm. And when I get involved with a dealership, I've been involved with thousands, and I've got a reputation for growing dealerships to the big numbers. We mandate the CRM. That's one of the first things I do as a consultant in the dealership. The CRM is not optional. We use every function that the dealership has agreed to use. And with Dealer Socket, I got to admit, I'm going to some dealerships that we're not using that function. We're going to use this function. We're going to use this function every time. Does that make good sense?
Yep.
You know, yeah. Because the CRM is not everything for every dealership. Now tell me about some other products and applications. CRM excites me. I'm just like you're excited about your accounting, I'm excited about CRM. Tell me some more applications.
So I would think I would continue on with that point about, at my core, a lot of my background has been in accounting and finance and definitely in the sales game as well. And I love the story that you tell where you showed up with, and don't let me misquote you here, but with the mattress on top of your car, you rolled into Atlanta. Is that where you rolled into?
I came into Atlanta. It was the, April 28th, 1982. Broke, divorced, pissed off, driving up the street, my buy here, pay here car, the mattress is on the roof.
Yeah, exactly. And from there, you then transform. You have a journey. Something happens between that point A and then point Z, so to speak, to this transformation to becoming so successful. And I think that's what good technology is, what helps us hold accountable and coach up and enable, there's that word again, right? Better resourcefulness from the assets that we have, and our assets and our resources of the dealership are our people, right? And that's the way we got to think about that. And I think one of the ways that we do that, we got to think about how does our CRM or whatever technology we're using, how does it help us hold our people accountable? Because I think at their core, most people at the dealership actually want to be held accountable. They want to be held accountable. They want to be challenged. And they want to feel like they're having success. So I think our reporting aspects and our tools do a great job of that. I think from our website side, the web offering, our DealerFire offering with the SEO, the SEM, the pay-per-click, all of that, it's a very consumer-first, very consumer-driven model that's focused on creating just a better experience as well. If you look at from the usability, the interface, the personalization that our websites and our offering comes with, as well as just the organic rankings and the way to think about it, whether it's social, whatever it is, finding a more intelligent way to do it and then tying that in with the CRM platform, that's the benefit there, which is our Crossfire application, which gives you visibility way upstream. If I'm a sales rep, to understand way upstream how my buyer is buying online and where they're going. And maybe Melissa can talk to the Crossfire functionality a little bit better.
Yeah. Are we embedding some pixels here?
Maybe.
Maybe. tell me about it, Melissa.
So in an ideal world, technology, as we've been talking about, should enable process. It should help with accountability. But what I think it really serves to do now is to provide dealers with technology that will help them sell customers the way that customers want to be sold. And that's changing now. And I keep referencing the fact that there's a lot of great new technology out there, but at the end of the day, if it's not easy to use, then you don't have a good customer experience. And I can point back to a few months back, I was in the market for a car. It was time, and I was excited to put myself in the shoes of our dealers, our customers, and really experience firsthand what it's like when you have dealers that try to use this innovative technology. And some dealers do it really well and others miss the mark. But ultimately, what we want as a customer is we want to trust you. We want to know that what you say, what you share is what I can expect. And guess what? I want it to happen in like less than an hour, right?
Yeah. And oh, so timing.
So, you know, going back to the digital retail platform, that seems to be what everybody's talking about with innovation in our space today. And DealerFire, DealerSocket's Precise Price Program, at least me personally, provided a really amazing experience to be able to go on to the dealer's website, work my own deal, both a retail and a lease comparison. And then I knew that final number that I was going to expect to pay. And where DealerSocket is different with Precise Price and DealerSocket is now the customer walks into the store, and because our digital retail program is tied into our desking, it saves a tremendous amount of time for me as a customer walking into the store, and the accuracy of the numbers is there. You're not having to rework the deal and come back and say, oh,
the numbers are good. The numbers, that's one thing. In so many dealerships, I have stood in thousands of showrooms. I've desked deals in every state except Alaska. So, I mean, we're talking experiential observation, not something I read or heard about.
Yeah.
And most technology slows down the process. And when I was talking to Mr. Munoz in your company a week ago, he talked about how you've cut so many clicks out of everything, and you've gotten it down to where it's functioning at that speed.
Yeah.
I think one of the things, Jim, for me, especially with respect to this digital retailing, the Precise Price offering, that's our digital retailing offering. I was at J.D. Power last year, and there was a lot of talk about the Amazonification of cars selling, right? That it's going to be one click, and everyone's going to want to buy that way. I believe that you have to be able to cater, that our dealers have to find a way to retail to their consumers in the way that the consumer wants to be sold to. If you think about the car buying process, if it's a 10-step process, some may, I think it's a minority today, but some may want to be all 10 steps online. Some might want to be 7 of those steps. Some might want to be 2 of those steps. Some people may still want to be 0 of those steps, although the data doesn't really prove out there, because most people are actually going to the internet first to do at least some research, right? But I think the dealer has to be nimble enough and agile enough to serve their customer in the way that they want to be sold to. So if I want to do 6 of those steps online and then walk into the showroom, then you should be able to engage with me in that way. And that's what I love about Precise Price. It's not saying, hey, guess what? Everyone has to run through this funnel in the exact same way. No, it can adapt to the way that you want to be sold to. And I think that being agile in that sense is really, really important, especially going forward, because you're going to have millennials, right? That who knows, maybe a subscription model becomes their thing that they want to adopt into, right? I mean, all these things that car business is changing quite a bit. Who knows the next 10, 15, 20 years what it looks like, but I still think no matter what we do, you're going to have to serve customers the way that they want to be served. And I think this gives you that dynamic and ability to do so.
Melissa, let me ask you a question now. You're the sales end of this team, correct?
Correct.
I got a face for radio.
I was in radio for years. I fully understand. Melissa, if somebody wanted to schedule a demo and take a look at what you're doing, what number would they call? Would they call you?
They can call anyone. We'll get you the number here in just a second.
Yeah, tell me the number. I'll put it on the side screen so the viewers can fruitless if they can't get in touch with you.
So we are. By the way, this is not my personal. I feel like I'd get some date requests. I'm seeing a lot of men that are watching right now. So this isn't my personal cell phone.
No, wait a second. There's one there.
There we go. Hi, Leanna.
Look what you said.
It's great. We need more women in the car business. That's for sure.
Hey, she is a powerful woman herself. I'll tell you, she's a good friend.
So to schedule a demo at NADA, someone will want to dial 949-900-0300, and we'll get you set up with one of our product experts. We'd be happy to show you anything that we've talked about today. And I do want to point out.
Tell me that number one more time.
949-900-0300. And if you go to dealersocket.com as well, right on our homepage, there's a link to our NADA site where you can schedule as well. And dealers can get a $50 gift card just for seeing a demo at the show.
The what?
Uh-huh. Yeah. Giving away the money and then helping you make it.
Oh, God, you're buying them off. I can. Okay.
So that's great. A point about reducing clicks. And I wanted to bring up Blackbird. We rolled out 2 years ago now at NADA, and it was a huge event in our industry because we were the first to really have the robust features of our CRM that so many dealers love and trust and give it a really modern, clean design. And I will say in the 2 years, we've made so many improvements to the performance, to the speed, to the functionality. We've really listened to our dealers, and perhaps we can talk a little bit about how we've done that. But if
when Blackbird first came out, it was interesting. Your new clients just flew with it, but your old clients had a learning curve and they had frustrations. Yeah. Is that pretty accurate?
That's pretty accurate. And I think that that goes to say without, you know, with any CRM or any technology change that you make, there's definitely a learning curve to it, and we've done our best to make sure that it's as intuitive as possible and that the workflow is really simple and drives the natural flow that we use to sell. And then we've also really invested heavily in resources internally with our hands-on lab virtual training program to get dealers the training that they need. Because it doesn't matter how easy it is, you got to show me how to use it. Depends on what type of learner you are, right?
Right. That's one thing I admire about DealerSocket. You've always been a training-based company, training your clients on the product applications.
Yeah.
And I understand that's even intensified in recent months.
Absolutely.
That's right. So really, the we've been making a big push on three fronts, Jim. If you think about it from, you'll talk to most folks around here and they all understand it. We're working on strengthening the core. That's one. We're working on being operationally excellent. That's two. And then three, we're focusing on expanding and growing. And it comes in that order. So strengthening the core gets down to working on the fundamentals of our business, all the way from the technology infrastructure and the speed of the application, limiting and reducing any defects that might be in the application, the things that Melissa was just talking about, Blackbird, and making all these improvements, and then our website becoming the fastest response time on a website. These features, and just the core functionality, really focusing on that, really investing in our people, which is our core. So the internal training that, you know, the outside world doesn't see, but the amount of internal training and requirements and continuing professional education for our own people, because we believe that knowledgeable, happy employees will result in knowledgeable, happy customers. And that's really important to us. So the next thing is being operationally excellent in all that we do. So we've invested a ton of time, energy, and effort in improving the onboarding experience for what we do, improving the ongoing support and ongoing training experience, opening up what we call hands-on lab or a virtual classroom, opening up access to that to anyone who wants access to it. We've created hundreds of on-demand videos that are 3, 4, 5 minutes each that can be taken on the dealer's timeline at any time. We've opened up a chat feature in support so that it's just one less thing to do. Our hold times in our support center are now best in class.
Averaging that's interesting.
A minute and a half.
That's extremely interesting.
Yep. So we've really invested a lot of time, energy, and effort on that sense. And then the expand and grow is we're doing some pretty amazing things with several of the OEMs, from everything from digital retailing and think about from a large customer, large franchise customer, like the enterprise type view, just trying to create a better user experience for our dealers and for the OEMs. Everything from digital retailing.
Okay, I just had a little blip there. Sorry. Oh, golly. That's a mouthful. Right now, it appears my camera is down, so I'm going to let you guys do the whole show from now on.
Does that mean I don't have to sit so close to him?
Oh, I thought you liked it. Okay, tell me a little bit about your plans for the NADA convention coming up this week. What are you going to be doing, and how's it going to be?
Well, we're excited about that. We've got a full team going. We are booth 2759C. So anyone attending, please stop by and say hello. Phenomenal location. You won't miss us.
Right across the restroom with snack bars, best.
That's right.
Yeah, we're not in the back by the bathrooms like we were a few years ago, but we have, as per usual, a beautiful booth. Our marketing team's done a great job putting together the best looking booth. Maybe we'll win again this year. We're a multi-year winner for the best booth. We have plenty of demo stations for our dealer fire products where we'll be showing precise price, showing how configurable, fast, people showing Blackbird, which again, if you saw it several years ago, definitely plan to come by.
You've got to re-see Blackbird. You really do.
Oh, yep. You really do. I mean, we have 90.
You haven't seen the current iteration of Blackbird. You haven't seen the product.
That's right.
That's right.
Yeah. It's new for the show. We have 9 new widgets alone on the homepage. And what that really does is it gives each user a custom CRM experience. So if he's the GM, he logs in and anything that's relevant to his world as a GM is on his screen. If I'm an internet manager or, BDC manager or BDC salesperson, anything that I need to do in my day to day is on there. So
I think one of the interesting things for me is the new Blackbird. Just like you said, Jim, I think it's worth saying again. I was just at a dealer in Springfield, Missouri, a good friend of mine. He's been running that store for a long time, a Chevy store out there. And he said with the turnover that they have with new salespeople, getting them up to speed and trained on Blackbird now, they've been on it now for about 3 months. They converted over from the classic view of what we have. He upgraded to Blackbird. And he said it's made a world of difference, even just onboarding some of these new folks that walk in their store with the new sales rep. So definitely we're seeing speed has definitely increased. I love the configurability and all of it. If you're a current customer, we would love to have you come by the booth. We'd love to see you. We're going to have some support staff there. If you got questions, some product experts there, some of our CSMs and CSM directors, we would love to show you our gratitude and would love to come shake your hand and meet you and talk more with you if you're a current customer and try and solution. If you got any questions, if there's anything we need to help, we want to help you out.
When you talked about Springfield, Missouri, I've got a client that's been my client for over 30 years in Springfield, one of the biggest Cadillac GMC dealers in the country, Thompson Motorsales.
Yep.
Lynn Thompson.
Yep, I know the guys at Reliable Chevrolet really, really well. The Randall Hargis, phenomenal guy.
I can too, yes, imagine that.
Yeah, exactly. That's the home of Outdoor World or Bass Pro Shops, Springfield, Missouri.
I saw the first Bass Pro Shop there 30 years ago.
Wow.
And I mean, it was the original.
Yeah.
Are you a fisherman?
Yeah, a little bit. I've been to Alaska, I've been to Hawaii, I've done a little bit.
Well, I'm living in Central Florida now. One of the main attractions here was the bass lakes.
Yeah, that's right.
We're having a ball. Debbie and I moved to Florida back in October after 35 years in Atlanta. And Melissa, actually it was you, Darren, we mentioned with the mattresses on the roof. And
that's right.
How I became a millionaire within 5 years. Well, the secret was I met my wife and sold her a car.
And is that how you met her?
I put her in a ditch. I made so much money on that deal, it was crazy.
You paid for it later, didn't you? And then some.
I made every payment. And she was from a pretty prominent family. And, I was a pretty rough guy. Not that I'm not now, but I was really rough then. Bar fighting and drag racing were only hobbies. And I said, when we talked about getting married, she said, My parents aren't going to have it, me marrying a car salesman. I said, well, what if I was a manager? So I went to the dealer, Brad Greer, and I said, Brad, look, I need to be a manager.
Well, one of the things that you did that I think always impresses me is the fact that your approach is you should treat the business as though you were getting an MBA in any other or a master's degree. Let's call it that. In any other profession, right? I mean, treat your profession. Whatever you're going to choose to do, do it well. And that's something that I could not agree more with. I mean, become a real student of the profession because it's only going to help you, right?
And you have to be adaptable. That's no secret. I'm 71 years old. I've been in this business 42 years. I've set world records in some aspects of the variable side. And Here I am, 71 years old, teaching internet to young people.
That's right.
You know, I'm speaking to Digital Dealer here on the 10th, and I'm doing a presentation. So you want to be a general sales manager? What makes you think you're qualified?
I love it. I'm speaking there as well. I want to come into your session. I'll sit into it.
9 o'clock Monday, opening session.
Awesome. That's terrific. Yeah.
So we got all kinds of time, guys. Tell me some more about Dealer Psychic. Tell me something revolutionary that I haven't heard.
I think one of the things that's really new for us, to be honest with you, is the fact that from a leadership perspective at our company, we've gone from 5 executives to 9 executives. So we're trying to invest and bring in some really, really good talent to add to the existing talent. Jonathan Ord, we have a new CEO, Jonathan Ord. I love that man. I've known him for
many years. He retired, didn't he?
What's that?
Did he retire?
Semi-retired is probably the way to think about it. I still talk to him 2-3 days a week. He's still very engaged in the business. He's going to be at NADA.
Great.
At Digital Dealer.
Great guy. I've only met him on a couple occasions, but yes.
Yeah. He is really a unique talent and an amazing guy. He's still very engaged in the business. Again, like I said, I live around the corner from him. I talk to him all the time about the business. I was just on the phone with him yesterday. Regarding the business, but we have a new CEO. She's phenomenal. She comes from outside of the car business, so she adds an interesting angle or perspective on our business, which has actually been really, really helpful. She is very much about very consistent execution in how we build our products, deliver our products, and support our products, and making sure that we partner up with our dealers. And that to me is really, really important. And she's come in with a real big focus on training our existing staff so that not only should you be able to get through to an individual, if you're a current customer, quickly from support or chat or your CSM, your account manager, but when you pick up the phone and talk to that person, they should be a knowledgeable employee that can get you answers, resolve things, and help you kind of make progress with the technology. So we've definitely been making some shifts there, and I think it's been really, really positively felt by many of our dealers. So that's a big change. And we've really been focused in on tenacious customer experience. You're going to see this new ad campaign that we're coming out with. It's called Game Face. And it's inviting our dealers to get their game face on. And again, I got a face for radio, but I'm one of the first in this campaign. I'm lucky that they kind of layer over a cheetah's face half over my face. So disguise it, and they do it in black and white, and they put a filter in Photoshop. So I look really, really good in that ad campaign. But it's about dealer testimonials and finding how do you put your game face on? How do you use our technology, or how do you make the most of running your business by having our technology enable what you do? Because you're the pro at running your business. And we're just
I talk about that every sales meeting. You know, did you show up today with that black crap under your eyes ready to play?
I love it. Yeah.
You got your game face on. I mean, game face has been part of my stick for a number of years. I love that.
Yep.
Because I credit my successes on intensity. You know, in the car business, you've heard me say this before, we don't have a knowing problem. We have a doing problem.
Yep.
People say, well, we need more training. No, we don't. We need more implementation of what they were trained.
That's
they
right.
Already know. They're just not doing it because nobody's supervising. Managers think they manage and forget that they supervise.
That's right.
Sorry, I got on a sidetrack there.
No, you're good. It's funny. I like you said, I'm going to be speaking at Digital Dealer. I think it's April 10th, that Tuesday at 2:30, I think, is when I'm speaking, about building loyal teams and strong teams in the car business. You know, turnover can be a big issue, right? And especially with 60% of new hires at the dealership are millennials, and the way millennials can be really phenomenal resources. They've got a whole talent set that many have never seen before, and it's something that's incredible. Women in the automotive space and the unbelievable talent set that they have, and really tapping into that and thinking about how we balance the new car guy, old car guy, how we kind of make the most of both of those worlds to build really solid teams to deliver a better experience to our customers and the consumers.
That's so important, because the high turnover in the car business is really to be expected, unfortunately, because it's a tough job. You know, Stupid people can't make it in the car business.
No,
uneducated people can make it. But
so it's funny that you, it's funny you say that again. I came out of a large public accounting firm, PricewaterhouseCoopers in LA, and one of the first experiences I remember was I went to the Stevenson Automotive Group in Denver, Colorado, and they have a 6-7 store group. And I'm sitting with all of their desk managers from all their stores. They were in the Toyota West store. And we were talking about desking, and without anything on the board and no calculators, these guys started running lease calcs and loan versus lease versus and all the different dynamics and variables from the lease rates and the money down and the cash incentives and like stacking these and the dealer pack, like walking through the entire deal all in their head. And I remember thinking, holy cow, I thought I had no idea that the car business, that these folks were this smart. These guys are really, really intelligent folks, that their minds are so quick to package up, put together, and they'd say, yeah, you're going to be at $615 a month. That's what the number should be on up there on the screen. And guess what? They were right. And we had one tax that was off, and they had calced it all in their head. I mean, they're just really intelligent people. And I think that's, you know, sometimes a knock is that people don't appreciate how intelligent you got to be in this business and be successful.
Well, you have to be a productivity person, and that's what CRM is about. Productivity, multiple projects. I was in the early 2000s, I was working with Prestige Ford in Dallas. And we took that dealership from 600 units to 1,000 units a month, every month.
Wow.
And we had a month where we did 1,700 units and actually beat Galpin.
Wow.
Well, a month. I mean,
wow. Yeah.
It wasn't, but we were, when I would sit on that sales desk, there were 7 or 8 salespeople in front of me all day long. And I would be sitting on a sales desk with 4 other managers shoulder to shoulder with 5 or 6 salespeople in front of them. We had 75 new car salespeople at that dealership.
Wow.
And when you tell us a salesperson, go say this to the customer, show them these figures, do this, here comes the next one. And by the time that other one gets back, what did I tell him? Her.
Yeah.
So to manage that many projects at the same time, and CRM was a godsend. You know, when I was selling cars, CRM was a 10 key and a Rolodex.
In your trunk, huh?
That's right.
Oh, it was. I mean, I have a flat file Rolodex with birthdays and dates, and I had another one with A to Z.
Well, one of the things that one of our early adopters, Josh Victor at Sam Pack's 5-Star Ford, North Richland Hills store, and there in Dallas, he's a phenomenal guy. And
yes, he is.
One of the first things that Josh would put up, literally printed out, he said, if it ain't in dealer socket, it didn't happen. Just because when you're trying to manage that many activities and that many moving variables, it's damn near impossible, right? And so you have to find a way to, it gets back to accountability and doing the right things, the right time, every time. That's what I think what you're looking for, but that's one of those things where technology can help you. If used well, it can really, really help you drive results.
Well, you know, I go in dealerships and I hear, well, Jim, that's old Joe. Old Joe can't do the CRM. Well, old Joe can't stay here. you know, the CRM rules. Marry your CRM. The CRM is the heartbeat of the dealership. You know, it's all the activity, everything that's happening. And if you can't learn new technology, and I'm a living example, you can transform. You can learn new technology.
Yeah, you're a great example. I mean, the amount that you would have, what the change you've seen in the car business, I 42 years, I can't imagine.
If you don't adapt, you're
in trouble, right? You'd have
to. Well, you know, I can show you pictures from the 80s of customers doing push-ups in the F&I office to qualify for credit insurance. It has definitely changed.
Yeah, it changed a little bit.
Oh, golly. Melissa, tell me one thing we haven't talked about.
I think one thing that we haven't talked a whole lot about would be probably a little bit more on the investment we've made on our internal teams.
What I wanted to hear today. Yeah. Now, you know, I had a great conversation with the Golden Boy the other day. Now, do you know about that, Darren?
No, I don't. Tell me about it.
Ruben Munoz, his family calls him the Golden Boy.
Yeah.
You're not going to let that get around the office, are you?
No, I'll only walk out of my office and go scream it from the
rooftop. Too late. Memo's out. No, I think it's important to talk about, you know, going back to what Darren said and Sejal and our new leadership, really investing in the people, because at the end of the day, if, you know, our customers have a better experience, then their customers will have a better experience. And so putting people at the point that are accessible, you know, any time of day or night, versus, you know, being on a plane, and that's our customer success team. We've really invested heavily in the knowledge that they have to support dealers and in our processes and technology for support. Darren mentioned the chat that lives within the CRM now, just quick, easy access to information and really being a true partner to our dealers. When I first started, our motto was that we're a consulting company that happens to have great technology. And I feel like over the last few years, you know, the focus has been more on the innovation and technology because, you know, quite honestly, it has to be a player in this space. But what I've been really pleased with what we've done is not quite pump the brakes, but slow to our roll just a little bit to make sure that we don't lose track of the basics. And the basics is what is a good partnership? A partner is being that person that when the dealer is struggling, he knows he can count on you to help him. That's really what it's all about, and that's what we've been investing tremendously on. I was on the training side at Dealer Socket for a number of years, and the technology investment we've made to make sure that our team and our dealers, of course, has access to information and can get their knowledge to where they're seen as that valuable resource to the dealer, that's paramount for us right now, and that's what we're working on.
Yeah, I think it's important that we're pretty transparent, right? I mean, we haven't been perfect. Be very candid. We haven't been perfect. We've made a lot of progress, and we really are doing some pretty phenomenal things. We did go through a period early last year where things as simple as hold times, it was tough. But we've candidly made the number of hours that we've put in has been incredible, an investment into our people to improve that. And they've really, you know, like I was saying, hold times within a minute to 2 minutes on average across all of our four product lines from where they were, it's dramatically improved. And are we at the top of the mountain ready to plant the flag and say we've arrived and we're perfect? No, no one would ever say that. But even our CSMs, we're making a massive push right now for them to get in the field, get with the dealers hand over hand, right, and meet with those folks, that we can always get better. I think the important thing is that we really want to try and make sure that we're always listening. I think about the glove, like it's like a white glove service in the Ritz-Carlton. And you want to think about that and think about how, that's a mantra internally that we've been using, is how do we provide a white glove approach? We're not perfect in that, but that's at least the ideal to which we strive to. And I think about the glove is the G stands, it's an acronym. The G stands for gratitude. We should thank every single dealer because they pay our paycheck and they put food on our table to pay for it, to provide for our family. So we should start with the G should represents gratitude. The L is we should listen. We should listen to our dealers very attentively. If you know anything about the Ken Garf ad campaign, is that they're all ears. If you're ever in Salt Lake, you'll see their billboards, and everyone it talks about how they listen very well as an automotive group. Well, we want to listen very well as well. The O in the glove stands for the opportunity to prove that we've listened to you as a customer by restating and not quickly jumping into trying to solution something. So that's the G, the L, the O. The V stands for showing and adding value to the dealer by fixing things, solutioning with the dealer. And finally, the E is executing on the expectations and setting the appropriate expectation going forward. We haven't done such a great job with that in the past, so maybe the last year and a half. But honestly, the last 6 months, we've really made dramatic improvements. in that sense. And that's the ideal that we're pushing towards. We're not perfect, but we're really headed down the right path. And we're starting to get phenomenal feedback. We have our NPS. I don't know if you know anything about that. It's Net Promoter Score feedback. It's basically us surveying our customers and gauging them. Like, you tell us whether or not we're getting better or whether we're not. And we've instituted things like the Delta Survey, which is what we call it. Every time you call into support, you'll get a question at the end of that phone support call, the same way that you get when you call into Delta. And it's one question. It's, would you hire the last person you talked to if you ran a call center, yes or no, period. It's like, don't give me a scale 1 to 5, just would you, yes or no, if you had to hire that person. And we take that very seriously, and we'll take that feedback and then rank our people and use that in coaching situations, because we have to use CRM internally, right?
Are you calling that the Delta program?
What's that? I'm saying we internally like to refer to that as the Delta survey, because Delta Airlines
uses that. That's what I'm thinking.
We stole it from Delta. I'm a Delta guy. I mean, I'm on the road pretty much every week. So, and I think they have great customer support. And so we're trying to take bits and pieces from different industries that we can. And that's where having a new CEO that comes from outside of our industry has a very interesting take on ways that we can do things to provide ultimately a better customer experience. So we're trying to be tenacious about improving customer experience.
You just said something that so many vendors do not understand. The retail customer is not your customer, the dealers are.
Yep.
And, you know, I see so many vendors today that have just overlooked their people paying their paychecks. And truthfully, I communicate with thousands, if not hundreds of thousands of people in the car business. With a keyboard, with phones, you know, I've got some large groups that don't exist, you know, urban legends that I have, some secret groups. Who knows? But I communicate with people. Truthfully, last year, you were having some issues, and you acknowledge that. But the feedback I'm getting now is it's so much better. It's exciting. It's emerging. It's coming. You know, and they really need to take another look at BlackBuy.
Yep, absolutely.
And to experience your support.
Yep. So we'd ask for that. I mean, we wouldn't be good salespeople if we didn't ask for business, right? So you might as well ask for it. We would open that invitation to everyone to please come experience that again. And if you're going to be at the show this weekend, we'd love to see you stop by booth 2759C. We've got a great location, and we've got some really good innovative items that I think you'll be really interested to come see.
Hey, Gary May's on here. There he is. See him on the screen? Yeah.
Awesome.
Okay, Michael Kirk. You know Michael Kirk?
Yeah. Definitely. Captain Kirk.
Yeah. Jason Rice says he's going to sit down with Dealer Socket at NADA this weekend.
My hometown, by the way, Jim. I'm a Vegas kid, born and raised.
Are you really?
Yeah, I'm a Vegas kid, so I'm going home. I've been there for a long time.
I've spent so much time in Vegas. I'm skipping this convention, by the way. I've attended over 35 conventions.
I was going to say, I heard that you weren't going. That's too bad. We won't see you there.
Well, I got a little disenchanted with NADA a couple years back. I think they're a little off track, and I've said so. I've written in the columns, and there's one corporation that has a whole city block at the conventions.
Small village. Yeah.
Cox Boulevard.
Well, we appreciate you. We'll see you at Digital Dealer, to be sure.
Yeah, we will. Any parting things we want to talk about or mention? I'm a big fan of Dealer Socket. I'm just admiring the things you're doing and have done. Anything we left out?
I think just, an offer of gratitude to, our Dealer Socket customers, and of course to you for having us on your show. We were really excited when you invited us to, and we're really excited to meet anyone that'll be attending NADA. And of course, You know, would love to talk to people into the future as well.
Yep. Thank you. Thank you to all of our customers, anyone that's online there and anyone that wants to come talk to us. And especially, Jim, thank you so much for making time to come to invite us to talk with you. Really appreciate
it. What happens here is these broadcasts, I've been doing them for about 6 months now, this format. And we're getting 2,000, 3,000 views in the replays.
Awesome.
You know, the live broadcast doesn't get but a handful of viewers, but the replays, check on this broadcast a week from now.
Will do.
And Facebook shows how many views are on the video. It might just amaze you. Well, listen, thank you, guys. I appreciate you being here, and I'll see you Digital Dealer for sure.
All right, brother. Appreciate it.